I'm Jake.
I'm Tom.
We are Velocities of Music. On this podcast, Tom and I discuss a litany of topics pertaining to modern music, including, but not limited to, artist deep dives and monthly and annual new music wrap-ups. Today, it's the beginning of May. It's time to wrap up April new album releases.
All right.
And there were a lot of them.
Yeah. Stuff's picking up.
Before we get started, you can help support Velocities of Music. Subscribe to Velocities of Music on your favorite podcasting device to automatically get our latest podcast episode sent to your device each week. Also, Velocities of Music does not want your money. We also don't want to introduce ads to the podcast yet. Right now, all we want is for you to share Velocities of Music with family or friends whom you think would benefit from joining in on the music discussion Tom and I try to create every week. Tom.
Yeah.
I think before we get started, monthly wrap up, it's good to do a little State of the Union, little house cleaning, make sure we're you know, talking to the folks that listen to us blab on when we put these podcasts out. Our podcasts have been getting a little longer.
Yeah.
You know, we've been doing this, you know, it's getting on over 8 months now that we've been doing the podcast.
Holy crap. Yeah, you're right.
It's crazy, right?
Yeah.
And you know, and we started off, we're like, oh, we're going to start off, you know, 30 minutes. We're not going to do any audio clippings or anything like that. And we realized that just didn't serve the podcast listening experience very well. So we started doing song clips and we started going a little bit more into content. I remember our Modest Mouse podcast.
Yeah.
It was an artist deep dive. I personally didn't feel like it was our strongest.
No, I agree.
You know, and I feel like it, part of the reason was we were rushing it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So because of that, I think you and I have decided to err on the side of quality of the content over the time.
True.
Timeliness of the matter.
And also, I mean, it's in our nature to go on and on about
these verbose
things. Right.
Yeah.
It caters more to the way that we talk about things, which, you know, we still need to maybe pare down a little bit.
Maybe.
But
maybe. I mean, maybe. You and I really aren't into the whole brevity thing.
No.
And that's fine. I think that's you know, hopefully at least, you know, some of the content that we're spewing out every week or so provides value. Every week or so, though, I want to talk about that. Because our podcasts have gone up in length, and I mean, today we're going through at least 35 albums that came out in April, and if we're doing like a minute, an album plus a song clip, like it's probably going to be a long podcast, right? We're probably going to go well over an hour today, and the fact of the matter is that it just, you know, a lot of our podcasts, you know, the next podcast we want to do, this is a spoiler alert, you know, I mean, we save this for the end, but we want to do a post-rock genre deep dive. We're really excited about it. Both Tom and I are big post-rock fans. So we're really excited about this podcast that we're doing, but we want to absolutely kill it. We want to do a good job for you guys.
Yeah.
And that takes time for us to prepare. We have a ton of albums to listen to. Tom, I know you and I have already been digging into some post-rock.
Yep.
I got a lot more to get through personally. I got a lot on my plate to get through to be prepared for that. So, and I know that that's going to be a longer podcast.
Sure.
Point being, I think our podcasts are getting pretty long, and we're probably going to err on the side of longer podcasts with less frequent podcast releases. So we may have been getting like 3 to 4 podcasts from Velocities and Music a month. I think we're going to pare it down to probably 2 a month. You'll have the monthly wrap-up and then some big topic.
Yeah, maybe split things in half if it gets way too long.
Yep.
Then, you know, we'll allow ourselves the freedom of kind of deciding that as it comes, but we want to make sure that we're, you know, releasing content for you all, but also doing it in a way that's digestible and easy enough to follow.
Of course, this isn't just my and Tom's podcast. This isn't the Velocities of Music podcast. It's also your podcast, too. We want to hear your opinions. If you guys would rather us split this stuff up, have a longer podcast, but maybe split it up into multiple parts, let us know, because we could totally do that without much additional work. Would you say that's accurate, Tom?
Yeah, that's absolutely accurate.
So that would be one thing that we could do if it would benefit you guys, and then probably keep the monthly wrap-up as one cohesive, probably long podcast, hour and a half.
Mm-hmm.
But in the spirit of brevity, we should get to it.
All right, El Deuterino.
Oh, that's right, buddy. Thanks for getting the reference.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so without further ado, let's hit the monthly wrap-up for April 2016. First up, April 2016, Yesayer, their fourth record, Amen and Goodbye. Yesayer is an experimental indie rock band from New York. if that's relevant. I don't think it is. I don't think location's relevant anymore.
Sometimes it is.
You know, the world is flat.
Yeah.
So diving into the music, I would say I'm a relatively large Yesir fan.
Yeah.
A couple years ago, we saw him at 8035 and down in Des Moines.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right when Velocities of Music started in 2010, you know, they came out with Odd Blood. I remember that being one of my favorite.
You love that one.
Still love that album. Still mm-hmm. come back to it. Love it. In 2012, Fragrant World came out. Yes. And I remember that being kind of darker, a little bit moodier, more experimental. Really ended up liking that. And that's mm-hmm. the tour we saw them on. A couple years have passed now. Amen and Goodbye. You know, I got to say, I've listened to this record a few times. And while on first listen, I didn't think it really had much to offer, I'm starting to really enjoy it. Yesir's moving in a poppier direction on Amen and Goodbye, much more than they were on Fragrant World. However, not in the traditional sense. They're infusing more Eastern influences into many of these tracks. The general song structure is a bit more stretched out, built on repeated beats with repeating vocal melodies. In reality, this album mashes a lot of styles, influences, and sounds together, which makes it pretty original sounding.
Next up, we've got the much anticipated by Jake and myself, the new album from Andrew Bird called Are You Serious? Andrew Bird is a really prolific music prodigy, I would call him.
Yeah.
Very talented multi-instrumentalist, great songwriter. His last album was Break It Yourself, which we weren't too keen on, Jake. I feel like the direction he's going in, and I would say that Are You Serious actually kind of carries this from Break It Yourself. He's getting much more mature when it comes to his songwriting mm-hmm. and his compositions. It's a little more mellow. It's not quite as adventurous in sound, but it still has a lot of ambition in terms of the way that he's actually composing and writing these songs. I found Are You Serious to be a step above Break It Yourself, I would say. But I still don't find it to be quite as memorable as some of his older work.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to see that ambition and that energy come back, because I'm not quite feeling it here, but there are some great tracks on here.
He's clearly still experimenting with his craft, and I appreciate that. And I would say that the songs on this record are more simply structured from a compositional perspective. However, they still have that typical Andrew Bird flourish of quick changes to the song structure. The foundation of this sound is rooted in a simple beat with acoustic guitar and violin sitting on top, and that's it. No backing instruments or electronic flourishes on this record. Bird's vocals are really well sung, but the vocal parts don't find the same perfect melodies that they had on his earlier records, like Mysterious Production of Eggs and Armchair Apocrypha come to mind. Moreover, some of these tracks clearly succeed where others fall flat. I'm a huge fan of the title track, Are You Serious? Mm-hmm. Definitely going to be one of my favorite songs of the year. Overall, I felt this was decent. As an Andrew Bird fan, I'm biased, so I naturally kind of like
sure.
this. And to me, this one thing I have to call out is it's production. It is, this thing is just meticulously produced.
Yeah.
It's a chiseled
masterpiece.
He has
a great ear for that.
Yeah, but all in all, probably not one of his strongest records. Next up, we have Bibio, A Mineral Love. Bibio is an English electronic experimental musician, producer, depending mm-hmm. on which part of the Wikipedia article you read. And in 2013, he came out with an album called The Silver Wilkinson or Silver Wilkinson.
Yep.
And I remember, Tom, we really liked that record.
Yeah, we really did. I think we gave it a score in like the low 80s.
Yeah, because it infused a lot of really nice electronic melodies with really organic, nature-filled sound.
Sure.
I remember just feeling like you're kind of in a like walking through a national park, but still somehow connected to the digital world.
Yeah.
It was a really austere kind of music trip.
Mm-hmm.
This record sounds like Bibio, and after a really promising opening track, I get really disappointed by a lot of squelchy 70s-esque synths used in several of the tracks that divert from that Bibio sound. It gets worse as the album progresses. Some serious disco bass synths and dancey soulless vocals. There are a couple tracks on A Mineral Love I really enjoyed, but it was really hit or miss, and I can't get behind this as an album listen.
Next up, we have an album from Charles Bradley called Changes. This is soul music, kind of along the lines of James Brown, Sam Cooke, Otis Redding, if you're into some of those old school soul singers. Charles Bradley really takes it back to that era. I love this kind of music, and it is refreshing as hell to me to hear that someone is still making this in that classic kind of performance and production style. It's a sound that, to me, just never should have tapered off. It never should have gotten less popular. Yeah. It needs to keep on living. So I really enjoyed this. You know, the songwriting isn't at the level of some of the artists that I mentioned, but I think the performance is really great, and the songs are actually really pretty interesting.
Next up, the Canadian rock act Black Mountain pays homage to the great Led Zeppelin with their fourth album entitled Four Roman numerals.
Oh, I figured they were paying tribute to like Foreigner or Toto.
Foreigner.
That's not what I meant.
Oh, okay. Well, it worked. Nice job. Slipping the dad jokes. This is psychedelic blues rock. It switches with ease between spacey synth leads and sludgy guitar riffs. This album is very fun to listen to, and what they do very well. I particularly enjoy the synth aspect. Still, there isn't quite enough extremes in the dynamics to really grip me, and the style isn't anything overly original. The last three or four tracks in this album are incredibly strong, however, so it finishes really nicely. Yeah.
Next up, we have the new album from Weezer. Weezer, who are back after a little while. You know, they had a new album come out a couple years ago. It was late 2014. We didn't get a chance to review it, right, Jake. That one was called Everything Will Be All Right in the End. And now, a couple years later, well, really about a year and a half later, for all intents and purposes, we have the fourth self-titled color-themed album from Weezer with the White Album, not to be confused with the Beatles' 1968 double album masterpiece. But still, the White Album from Weezer. I gotta say, man, I had an interesting experience with this because the first time I listened to it, I did not like it at all. Hmm. And I think a lot of that had to do with the context and the environment I was listening in. I was listening to it in my car with my wife on the way down to Des Moines, like 30 minutes away from where we live. And it was just kind of in the background. I was like, oh, this just sounds like kind of poppy. Like, I'm not really into it much. But then once I took another more detailed listen, man, this thing just stuck with me. These songs are catchy. I feel like this is actually one of the strongest releases they put out in a long time. I will actually go as far to say I think it's probably the best, my favorite thing they put out since Maladroit, their fourth album, right, which a lot of people might even say it's better than that one. I like Maladroit a lot more than the average Weezer fan, so that's some important context to know. But what they're doing on here, I think, is they're just coming out of the gate with a lot more confidence than they've had in quite a while. They're making a consistent listen. They're playing to their strengths, not trying to be too deep. They're just having fun and kind of being whimsical Weezer.
Yeah. Some of us might even think it's their best album since Blue Album. I don't know who those people would be, though. To me, Weezer is really trying to get their sound back to what it was in the 90s. The guitars here play a much bigger role in the songs, and the production in general is much grittier and edgy, yet they still do have this pop feel, but I think a lot of that's due to the songwriting. You know, there definitely is some track disparity on this record, but I find myself really enjoying a lot of these songs. While it feels like the album listen is more of a compilation feel, I'm impressed by what I hear, and the songwriting is strong and the performances are really convincing. The more that I listen to this album, the more that I settle into just really enjoying it and thinking it's one of the stronger releases I've actually heard this year. Next up, we have the latest release from Mogwai called Atomic. If you're not familiar with Mogwai, shame on you. They're a great post-rock band. And this album is actually an original soundtrack from a documentary called Atomic, Living in Dread and Promise by Mark Cousins. I actually Haven't seen the documentary, but it sounds like something that's right up my alley. This, obviously, it's post-rock, but it edges towards the electronica side of post-rock. It's, mm-hmm. it's very, because it's a soundtrack, it's very free-form, sprawling movements that combine acoustic drums with large, spacey synths and lighter electronic melodies. It's a very post-apocalyptic, futuristic vibe, and the mood is somewhat devastating, which, all in all, are positive things for me.
Yeah, they really hit the nail on the head when it comes to that soundtrack feel. It makes sense in that kind of context. They're clearly just trying to set a backdrop and make things consistent. And for that reason, of course, it's not nearly as ambitious, adventurous in terms of melody, dynamics. All those things really permeated their previous album, Rave Tape. So you can tell they've taken it back a notch, but still, I'm just glad to hear anything from these guys. All right, Jake, we're staying in Scotland for the next album.
Awesome.
This one is from Frightened Rabbit, Painting of a Panic Attack. Frightened Rabbit is a rock band kind of along the lines of folk rock, I would say, yeah. in some ways. We've really dug some of their previous albums that we've reviewed. And now Painting of a Panic Attack. I feel like anymore, these guys are sounding closer to like Imagine Dragons or newer Coldplay than the Frightened Rabbit that I've come to know and love. That's not a compliment. The fun-loving sass seems to have been replaced with like a sound that I would describe as like kind of sulking self-pity on this album. And at risk of sounding like a crotchety old man here, which I know I do some of the time, the electronic touches that they inject into this album just do not work in the sound's favor. And some bands can pull that off. I just don't think it complements their songwriting style here. So to me, you know, it's not the worst music ever, but I was pretty disappointed in this one.
The sound simply lacks any edge or soul. Both the instrumentation and the vocals fail to convey emotion effectively. Plus, there just isn't a lot of well-crafted melodies. It's just reused tropes. Following Frightened Rabbit, we have the ninth studio record from PJ Harvey called the Hope 6 Demolition Project. PJ Harvey is an English alternative singer-songwriter. She's just pretty badass.
She's awesome.
She's been making great music for decades now. I'm a moderately big fan and becoming a bigger fan, I think, by the day of PJ Harvey. Hope 6 Demolition Project. The highlight here is clearly PJ Harvey's vocals. She has a way of making anger desperately beautiful. I really like the sound on this record. The sparseness of the guitar allows an intensity to build, and the vocals capitalize off of this with huge climaxes.
Next up, we've got an album from the palindromic band Taco Cat called Lost Time. This is kind of cutesy, fuzzy, slightly lo-fi alternative indie rock. I can put more modifiers and clarifiers on there, but I'm not going to. It is what it is, and you know, I think that it's not a terrible album. It's not bad in terms of songwriting. There's some good melodies on here, some good performances. But in general, I gotta say, I'm just kind of sick of this cutesy indie rock thing. It cares more about attitude and image than actually accomplishing something. And I mean, look at the band name itself. The band name is a meme. Like, the band name itself is a freaking meme. So what do you expect? I mean, that probably sounds harsher than I'm actually trying to be. Like, it's not the worst music out there, but it's just, with some of the other stuff coming out these days, it's very hard for me to care about.
This bored the shit out of me. It's called Lost Time for a reason. That's not just the album title. That's a warning. If you listen to this, your time will be lost, and you can never have it back. You will never get those precious minutes of your life back. Think of that before you listen to Taco Cat.
Also, Pet Shop Boys released an album, and it is a Pet Shop Boys album. Called us the
The next album is one of the most interesting albums I listened to this past month. It's the latest album from an artist called Bombino, called Azel. Bombino is a Tuareg guitarist and singer-songwriter from Niger. Now, I gotta admit, I'm not familiar with his music prior to listening to Azel. To me, I kind of called this guitar-based world music with kind of a Latin vibe, lots of big beats, hints of reggae in the bass of the beats, lots of vocal backings over the melodic electric guitar melodies. There are a lot of really catchy hooks driven by both the vocals and the guitars, which make this really enjoyable to listen to. Still, it's a bit niche, not something I'm going to come back to often, but I'm certainly glad I took the time to listen to this thing. Following Bombino, we have the seventh studio record from my favorite post-rock band, Explosions in the Sky. They're from Texas.
Yep.
We've seen them a couple times in concert, Tom. Fantastic every
great
time.
Great show.
Their latest album is called The Wilderness. The Wilderness seems to have a more earthy and atmospheric sound in comparison to the blistering emotional rawness of previous Explosions in the Sky records. This record almost has a Godspeed You Black Emperor sound. They accomplished this from a songwriting perspective by stripping down the compositions to focus more on one instrument at a time rather than the all-out attack we are familiar with from this band. For the production, they ensconced everything in reverb and often delay. Every note seems to linger, creating a huge space with their sound. You get the emotion you would expect from Explosions in the Sky. It just seems more organic and matured on The Wilderness. Come to think of it, it's a perfect title for this album.
Next up, we have, lo and behold, the new Kanye West album, The Life of Pablo. We're actually going to talk about it now because the guy decided to actually finish the damn thing.
Oh, he finished it.
I think so.
And it's on Spotify.
It's
officially released.
Right. Well, I mean, we might get a new version like next year or something. I freaking know.
Right.
I don't know what the guy's doing.
So what changed?
Anymore.
So he originally released this on Tidal or something like that. But like it was an unfinished version.
Well, my understanding is he's like changed the track order and added new songs and maybe remix some of them. The thing is, I don't really know, and I don't really care to keep up with it.
Everybody out there realizes this is exactly what Apple does with their product. This is a product.
I don't want to be a beta tester for Kanye West's new album.
Right.
Tell me when your freaking album is done, and I'll listen to it. So that's what I did. So honestly,
The Life of Pablo and The Life of Pablo S.
Pablo, yes. Pablo, the new version. The new Pablo.
The Life of Pablo Honey.
God. There's a... where's Danger Mouse with that mashup album? That would be, oh my God, that would be cringeworthy as all hell.
Terrible.
So anyway, Life of Pablo, let's actually get to it here. So this album, I gotta say, some of the styles here and the beats are really cool. I mean, that's something that Kanye has always excelled at, and I don't think that he's lacking on this release. In general, I like the lack of choruses and the more kind of collage-like approach. The way that the songs flow and develop is still very progressive. This is something that he's really, to some extent, always done, but I feel like really perfected on My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, and he's still using those kinds of songwriting techniques here. Just the thing to me is that while there's a lot to like in structure and approach, there isn't a lot to like in terms of content for me. I don't really dig the lyrics. There's still a lot of those just awful Kanye lines that just make me shake my head and facepalm all over the place. It just feels kind of bland and doesn't really accomplish much. I will say there are a few highlight tracks. There are some that really stuck out to me, especially the opening track. I actually thought was incredibly strong, and a couple others spread throughout, but there was enough that I just felt like I was getting dragged through that overall I wasn't super impressed.
Yeah, I liked this album pretty well on first listen, and then I listened to it one or two times more. And just really the bad songs seemed to stick out more the more I listened to it. And just the fact of the matter is there's several just absolutely horrid tracks on this record. This thing kind of pops around stylistically, which I think is a good thing in general for Kanye, but like there's just a lot of unforgiving qualities here. If you want to have a great record, you can't have tracks tracks that are just terrible that everyone is going to skip. And I would say that this album certainly has most people are going to just have their favorite tracks and they're going to skip through to those and that's all they're going to listen to. And that's just not a good record, especially when you take two tries at releasing it, you know? Like, it just says to me that this really wasn't about the music. And I would argue that My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy and Yeezus, his previous two albums, did focus on the music more.
Yeah.
And while they weren't perfect albums, they were much better than this. When was the last time I remember the birthday? When was the last time I wasn't in a hurry? Tell me you want them tickets when it's game time. Even to call your daughter on a FaceTime. Even when we was young, I used to make time. Following the life of Pablo, we have the eighth studio record by alternative metal band Deftones. Tom, do you like Deftones?
Oh, dude.
Oh, yeah.
I love Deftones.
We actually saw them in concert a number of years ago.
Yeah.
Right after White Pony came out. Not White Pony.
Diamond Eyes. I wish.
Yeah, that would have been great, too.
I was like 10.
I mean, Diamond Eyes was a pretty good record.
It was freaking awesome.
2010,
I love it.
One of the best records, our favorite records that came out in 2010.
Yep.
In 2012, they came out with Koi no Yokan, which I remember liking pretty well.
Yeah, I really like that one.
Gore is a bit of a shift in sound here. I want to say the sound is more stripped down on Gore. I feel like there's really two distinct halves of this record. The first half is a bit more visceral. You have Chino Moreno, his infectious, haunting vocal presence. It plays a big role, as it always does in Deftones music, but really the sound is stripped down. You just have some like real chortling electric guitars over just pretty bombastic reverb percussion. And you have a lot of just kind of grind there. And a number of tracks are like that in the front half of the album. In the back half, I really start to like this album a little bit more, with some more melodic tracks. Honestly, what they're adding is in the songwriting, they just seem to shift to add a lot more melody. And I think that by doing that, they really round out the back half of this album and make this a more pleasing experience for me. I will admit this was a bit hit or miss for me, but I liked it more as I listened to it. And I probably listened to this one 5 or 6 times this month.
Yeah, Deftones are always a band that requires several listens for me.
Yeah, definitely.
And maybe that's because they're one of my favorite bands and I just have to get over expectations. Maybe it's just because the way they write songs, it takes a little bit of digging. And I actually found that Gore required even more digging than most Deftones albums. And I think a lot of that actually has to do with the production.
Yeah.
The production is weird here. It's closer to this kind of like grimy, muddy, like post-rock or post-metal sound, often with Chino's vocals just kind of soaring over the mix. Like, it's not something that I'm really used to from them, because they're a band that oftentimes in their production style has very crisp separation between all of the instruments. Here, everything is reverbed together. The mix just sounds like one swirling mass of rock. But aside from that, it's also more uplifting and actually kind of like brighter and more positive in a lot of ways than their past work. That's not to say this is pop by any means. It's still Deftones, but when you compare it to their past releases, I found this to be a little bit more uplifting in mood. So that's a little bit different, and I don't think it's their strongest emotional appeal that they can pull off when they're better at some of that just hard-hitting energy. But while this certainly wasn't a disappointment to me, I still really liked it. I don't think that it's one of Deftones' stronger releases. After Deftones' Gore, we're going to talk about M83's Junk.
Ew.
It's a kind of, going all over the body here. So it's been 5 years since their last album, Hurry Up, We're Dreaming, a double album, which we actually liked a lot. And what they seem to have done on Junk, sounds so fucking weird to say. what they've done on Junk is they've kind of gotten rid of some of that ethereal and moody quality in favor of the more kind of indie pop disco yacht rock that seems to be happening a lot right now in this genre. Honestly, I don't really get that. Because I feel like this guy has had a good thing going. Like, he's a really unique kind of experimental artist historically. Now, I will say, I think this is still somewhat more dynamic and artistic than what a lot of artists are doing in that sound that I mentioned. But I feel like it's a significant step backward from Hurry Up, We're Dreaming.
Next up, we have the eighth studio album from ambient electronic artist Tim Hecker. I'm a big Tim Hecker fan. His 2011 mm-hmm. album, Rave Death 1972, which we actually reviewed in 2011, just blew my mind. And I still come back and listen to that album quite frequently. His follow-up to that, Virgins, in 2013, was it took that same mood and style that he was going for.
I loved that one.
And it made it even more organic sounding with a lot more... the thing that sticks out to me was he used a lot more bells in the composition, and I think it just created this very organic sound. So I was really excited when Love Streams, his eighth album, came out this month. Love Streams sounds like Tim Hecker is shifting back to the similar sonic motifs that he used back on Rave Death 1972, that 2011 area, versus the more organic sounds of Virgins. There is definitely more digital electronic feel to this song. To these songs, you really have a pulsating distortion, which plays a big role on a lot of these tracks. There's lots of organ sounding keys that add a lot of color and melody to the tracks, which Hecker probably did intentionally, as several of these track names reference color. This seems more exploratory than either of the two previous records I mentioned, which provided a more focused sound centered around providing devastating emotional impact. The result is still a great ambient electronic record. It just doesn't carry the same weight, though, as his previous two albums.
Next up, we've got Hammock, Everything and Nothing. Some more post-rock. This is cool. We're hitting several post-rock albums this month, Jake, whereas weren't we just complaining a couple months ago about the lack of post-rock
yes.
that 2016 yes. has had?
Yeah.
And now we're going to do our deep dive of it for the next
podcast.
Well,
there's like three post-rock albums this month, and then right. we're going to do the podcast. I mean, right. we're just going to have an overload
immerse
of post-rock.
Ourselves.
It's great.
We will be laying in a hammock of post-rock.
Oh,
and that's
I see
what we're
going to
talk
there.
About today. With their new album, Everything and Nothing. This is more ambient kind of post-rock, though. Probably closer to bands like Saxon Shore or Caspian and terms of the mood that they're trying to create here, which is a little bit more mellow. It's very soft and smooth with these subtle electronic touches that are kind of drifting in the background. I love this sound, and there are some really great tracks on here, and broken down more specifically, some really good guitar riffs. But I will say, I think the length is a little unjustified. At about 76 minutes, I really think that this could have been about half as long, at 38 to 45 minutes, somewhere in there, and probably even more potent for it.
Yeah, I found this album to be really enjoyable. I will admit, like, the first time I listened to it, it certainly had the same effect. Like, if you're mm-hmm. if you're objectively just sitting down trying to evaluate this record, yeah, the length is probably a bit long. But I found that just the general mood and aesthetic that it establishes is something that it provides a function, right? This is very functional post-rock. I was able to put this on and let it play in the background and really enjoy it. And so I ended up listening to this a number of times. Following Hammock, we have the fifth album from Future of the Left, called The Peace and Truce of Future of the Left. It's kind of an intriguing album
yeah,
title.
Mm-hmm.
I was really excited to listen to this. Listening to this got me really excited because it's alternative metal. And we've seen a serious shortage of quality new metal or heavy metal releases in 2016. This reminds me of what you would get if you crossed Graham Coxon's solo work with Primus. Just has a very heavy, yet somewhat kind of quirky sound.
Yeah, kind of fun and like kind of all a satirical way.
Yes.
I completely agree with the comparison you made. I would even throw back to longer ago to bands like Faith No More and the Jesus Lizard with this kind of like grungy metal sound, but that focus on bass, I think, is a big part of it. This is just really good, intense rock. It's fun to listen to. It's unique. The songs are interesting, and they just keep me hooked throughout. I love the energy of this. This is definitely one I'll come back to.
Finally, Following Future of the Left, we have Woods with their 9th record in 10 years.
Jeez.
That is prolific.
It is.
This album is called City Sun Eater in the River of Light. City Sun Eater in the River of Light. So two very interesting album titles in a row, too, Tom. So these guys, Woods, they're from Brooklyn, New York. They're considered a folk band, but I would call them folk rock or indie folk more than I would call them like a folk band. I think this is a fairly strong presentation as far as like indie folk, indie rock goes. The songs are structured around simple beats, reverbed acoustic and electric guitars, followed by melodic, Ween-esque is what I would compare it to, vocals sitting on top of the mix. This has an alt-country tinge to it, which provides a really nice mood and authenticity. Some songs have a neo-psychedelic vibe as well. The songwriting is varied enough that I was able to stay interested, and the instrumental performances are up to snuff enough that I found this pretty enjoyable to listen to. All in all, a pretty solid record.
All right, next we've got the new album from the Lumineers, who you may know from their somewhat ubiquitous hit, Hey Ho, or is it Ho Hey? I don't really remember.
I don't think it really matters.
It was all over the place. Yeah. It cycles back to whichever one. So these guys just exploded a few years back with their debut album. And now we're on to their next album, Cleopatra. Now, I would say by no means is this really an engaging album, but it's not bad either. This group is keeping it pretty real, considering the somewhat overnight success of their debut. Still, I do think that level of success was a little bit of a fluke. You know, it's nice to see that it's not going to their heads like it did some bands, Mumford and Sons. Sorry, I gotta clear my throat there. But it's just, to me, it's a reminder of the fact that, you know, while these guys are good, they're talented, I don't know if they were really ever meant for the spotlight. I almost think that they're better as one of those just kind of indie pub bands. But what they do pretty well. Dealt you a tricky hand, and now you're just left alone in your mind. Next we have the album Love Letter for Fire, which is a collaborative album of duets. That's a nice word, duets. Duets.
Twin, Tom, is my favorite word.
That's true.
I think duet might be up there.
All right.
Random trivia in there. So if you guys haven't heard of this record, you're probably not into indie folk music. Singer-songwriter Sam Beam of Iron and Wine, he is Iron and Wine for all intents and purposes, pairs up with singer-songwriter Jessica Hoop, right? Jessica.
That's how I would pronounce it, Jessica. Man. I don't know. I don't know her, so I don't know.
You want to say Jessica, but it's not Jessica. It's Jessica Hoop.
Could just be Jessa, Jessie.
Yeah, I'm just going to say Hoop.
It might be Kesha.
For the rest of this little mini review, I'm going to say Hoop. So Sam Beam and Hoop made this album of duets called Love Letter for Fire. So to actually talk about the music, I think that the aspect of Love Letter for Fire that is less than amazing is the reused chord progressions and folk music tropes that we are so familiar with in Sam Beam's music. If you've listened to Iron and Wine, then you will have heard most of the songwriting tropes that you've heard on previous Iron and Wine albums. That said, his craft is very robust and performances are very good and polished. The combination of Jessica Hoop adds a variety of authenticity to the folk presentation. This record really does have an organic, folksy, homegrown feel to it, which is highly appealing for albums operating in this genre. I like this record. I'm not in love with it, but it's certainly enjoyable. I could hear, but my hands are cold. You could let me in broken bones. Letting love keep climbing the stairs to comb your lawn.
Next up, we've got some more kind of country folk with Sturgill Simpson's new album, A Sailor's Guide to Earth.
I love that album title.
It's a great album title, and it really conveys the kind of progressive take on country that Sturgill Simpson brings. I love his approach to this genre. It's very refreshing, and the songwriting and performances here are just plain good. Mm-hmm. Now, he's doing a lot with song structure. He's putting a lot into the mix, bringing elements to country like atmosphere and instrumentals that just aren't typically there. I will say by the end of it, I was hoping for some reason to have like a little bit bigger of an impact. By the end of the album, I found myself thinking, wow, that was really good. That was really original. But the songs themselves individually didn't really stick with me well enough to really love it. But I still enjoyed it a lot.
Next up, we have the third record from Canadian rock band Sons called Hold Still. Interesting how they structured that. A couple years ago, Tom, we reviewed their second record, Sons' second record, Images du Futur.
Yes.
Images du Futur.
Images du Futur.
And I remember liking that album. I remember thinking it was pretty good. And then there's a couple tracks that really stuck with me. Actually, one of them still in my running mix. So whenever I go a run, I listen to it on a regular basis. So I was pretty interested to see what Hold Still would provide. You know, it's been a couple years since I've really dug into this band's music. Where Images du Futur combines solid songwriting with trancey moods, Hold Still sounds much more towards the trance, which with less emphasis on developing songs via songwriting tactics. This is all about mood and abrasion. They are literally trying to drill their contorted, muffled, clangy sound straight into your head like an auger drill. The result is a polarizing listen. I can fully understand and respect why someone would love this simply for the scope and the achievement of the sound. On the other hand, there was several times on this record where I found myself asking myself, what is the point? Never a good thing.
Next, we have the new album from the Jayhawks, Paging Mr. Proust. This, to me, in style, falls under the category of really extremely polished, well-produced, performed, almost kind of adult contemporary type rock. That to me, it's not bad, but this is something I have trouble getting excited about, guys, and I'm sorry. It reminds me a lot of other acts that have kind of flora and fauna-based names. The Eagles, Plants and Animals, Blind Melon, at times Grizzly Bear. These all, I feel like, kind of belong together. There is a lot of talent here, but to be honest, I got a little bored. Now, Jake, I see this is one we're a little separate on. Yeah. I think you like this one significantly more than I did.
Yeah, I think I did. And to be honest, this is just more my cup of tea.
Sure.
You know, I think this is, you know, pretty traditional indie rock bands, I would add, that this reminded me of a bit. I would agree with your assessment on all those flora and fauna-esque bands. Sure. And fauna, Dr. Dog.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Definitely
got
a big Dr. Dog vibe. Even a little bit of Spoon in there. So if you like bands like that, the Jayhawks, and you haven't listened to the Jayhawks, it might be a band that you want to check out. So Paging Mr. Proust. It's sad that this style sounds fresh in 2016. It just shows you how much music is completely saturated in synths right now. Paging Mr. Proust is centered around strummed electric guitar, a basic drum beat, and bass. A pretty traditional setup. The vocalist has a really nice voice that adds a good balance between edge and smooth tone. Plus, the vocal melodies are relatively catchy. Still, there really isn't anything groundbreaking on this record. It's just a straightforward alternative rock record, and I found that pretty enjoyable.
I think that our difference here, it actually kind of harkens back to an album that came out a few months ago. Tour and Breaks, that you liked a lot more than I did.
I've come back to that record.
Yeah.
Still like it.
I just didn't want to make that comparison at first because the name doesn't fit the motif that
I was
going for.
It didn't fit at all, no. Next up, we have another record from King Gizzard and the Lizard Wizard, Non-Agon Infinity. Now, we, on a podcast, like, I want to say November.
Yes.
Paper Mache Dream Balloon came out.
Yeah.
And I remember really liking that album. Mm-hmm. Kind of a, of Montreal, maybe a little bit more psychedelic rock of Montreal with a little bit of Tame Impala, sort of psychedelic rock. And I remember really liking it. And there's a few notable tracks that ended up, I think a couple ended up on our favorite songs list of 2015. And I think this is like their eighth or ninth album since like 2012. So another very prolific band. So Non-Agon Infinity, nothing like Paper Mache.
No, it's really not. And I love that.
Yeah, this is loaded with energy and ensconced in beautiful psychedelic fuzz. Definitely close to the sound of The OCs, a band we reviewed couple of years ago that we really liked. Driving, repeating bass riffs, spastic drums, clangy, distorted guitars, and an occasional synth in the background. This really has a punk edge to it as well that infuses a lot of energy into the sound. I felt this was a really strong record, but the sound does wear a little thin by the end of the album. There really aren't enough ideas present on this album for the sound not to go stale, and they just kept doing the same sort of shtick over and over again.
And I love how hard-hitting it is, but I think that you make a good point, Jake, in that after so much of that, you almost need for it to slow down a little bit in order for
some variety. Some contrast.
Right, exactly. But overall, this is a far cry from the kind of tree-hugging psychedelia of their last album. This really impressed me. I love the kind of math rock, crazy rhythms that they fit into this. I was just really digging the kind of balls-out approach, so this is definitely one I'll come back to. Next, we've got the new album from Grays called Outer Heaven. This is rock. This is kind of grungy, hard-hitting, fast-paced rock. Kind of reminds me of, like, Waves, if they were a little heavier and more interesting, I would say. This is very Nirvana-influenced. I liked some of the experimental aspects here, though. They keep it pretty fresh, which is really needed because while the musicians here are very capable, I don't feel like they bring a very unique or convincing spin to the genre, and that's especially true of the vocals. While the vocalist is very capable, I just feel like it kind of bleeds together with a lot of what I hear from this genre. I need something unique in that element.
Yeah, I also felt like he was just off key at times, and I honestly he kind of distracted from the overall presentation of the sound, which I thought was quite good, so it just kind of tore it apart for me and made this pretty hit or miss. Next up, we have a solo record from Nicholas Godin, who is one half of the musical duo Air. This album is called Counterpoint. Not Counterpoint, Contrapoint. I'd classify this as progressive ambient music that really is able to capture a lot of life and energy in its sound. We hear a good variety of instruments, both electronic and organic instrumental melodies, over variously placed beats and rhythms. The result is a surreal soundscape presented in a smorgasbord fashion. I found this to be very hit or miss. The stronger tracks I really enjoyed, however, there were some real stinkers on this record as well.
Next, we had an EP, actually, from the classic post-punk band Wire. This one's called Nocturnal Koreans. This album, it's a little more electronic than the last couple things that Wire's put out. Closer to the kind of their 80s sound. It's really pretty good, though. I find that smoother aesthetic works well with the writing on this album, and it's a little less abrasive melodies and performances. Overall, this is something that I enjoyed and would love to hear a full album's worth of. We also had a new album from hip-hop artist A$AP Ferg, always strive and prosper. Oh, stands for ASAP. Mm. I see what they did there. Mm. Now, this album flip-flops between some more interesting and actually fairly progressive for the mainstream modern hip-hop tunes that I actually really liked. But it goes back and forth between that and the kind of just radio club trash that I just cannot stand. It's a decent effort from this group, considering I'm not really a big fan of a lot of their stuff. And it's pretty good for radio rap, at least some of the tracks, but I don't feel like that's really saying all that much.
Next up, we have the latest record from Juju, who are a noise rock band, experimental noise rock. I don't know what the hell Juju are.
Kind of electronica.
In 2012, they had an album that came out called Always. And Tom, I remember just being weirded out by
it's
that.
It's some out there stuff, but I remember
coming around after listening to that thing a number of times. Several of the tracks just really won me over and ended up really liking that record. This record that in 2016, they came out with a record that is near and dear, the subject matter is near and dear to Tom and my hearts. It's called Plays the Music of Twin Peaks. So Juju plays the music of Twin Peaks. Twin Peaks, Tom, quick synopsis. What is Twin Peaks?
So Twin Peaks is...
It's not a restaurant.
No, and it's not the band of the same name either. It is a television show from the early 90s, was on for 2 seasons. Now, quick personal story here. So TV isn't something we get to geek out much on this show, Jake.
Well, this podcast isn't about TV.
it's
about music.
It is not. But Twin Peaks is my personal favorite television show of all time. That's right. Tom Hummer's favorite television show of all time, Twin Peaks. It is a magical David Lynch-directed masterpiece that just it's not perfect even. It's not perfect, but its flaws help make it this unique, moody, creepy, dark, funny, endearing beast of a television show that it is. It is beyond description. It almost like it ascends to the state of being more than just television. It's like a feeling in itself. Like I can't tell you how much I love this show. And Angelo Badalamenti's original music for Twin Peaks helps to make that. Now, quick synopsis, which is actually what you asked for, Jake, and I'm not gonna put any spoilers out there, but of course I would strongly encourage anyone who hasn't seen this show to go watch it. I know it's been on Netflix, maybe it's still on there if you're a Netflix user, but it's a terrific show, and kind of what it's about is in small town of Twin Peaks, there is a murder of a young girl, a high school girl named Laura Palmer, and what happens is this FBI agent, Dale Cooper.
Special Agent Dale Cooper,
who loves his cherry pie and coffee.
Yes, he does.
Comes to Twin Peaks to try to solve this crime. And what he finds is that in this seemingly innocent small town, there is a very dark underbelly, a lot of secrets to be hidden, and just some of the most gruesome things that you could possibly imagine happening under the happy, smiley facade of this early 90s kind of lumber-based town in the woods, right? So the thing that I love that Juju did with Plays the Music of Twin Peaks is, if you listen now, and I'm not sure if and Jake, I'd love to hear your thoughts on this, because I'm not sure if people who haven't seen the show and are familiar with the original music, the original score, will appreciate this as much. I still think there's a lot to like, but of course there's a huge bias here because this music means a lot to me and I think of it in the context of the show, right? So what I love that he does here, though, is the original music sounds kind of bright and kind of happy, and despite some darker motifs and sounds in the show, it sounds overall very clean and kind of happy in the show. I feel like what Juju does is he takes it and makes it match the content of the show more than that smiley facade that the town in the show has. So it really, all in all, this album is actually a better representation of what the show is all about, but it wouldn't really work with the visuals of the show because the whole point is that there's the contrast between the kind of like outside face of this town and the things going on behind the scenes. But I think that Juju just captures it perfectly. Next up, we've got Cowton with the album Utility. This is some pretty cool glitchy electronica. Overall, I like the compositions and the dynamics. The songs flow really well. My biggest complaint overall is that I don't feel like there's any subtleties here. I listened through this very specifically, and what I was listening for is everything in the mix, and everything that happens in the mix tends to happen right in the front and usually center of the mix. For me, I like electronica that's a little more layered, mm-hmm. has some things going on in the background, maybe in the peripherals of the sound. But overall, I like the sound choices and the mood they create. It reminded me of Caribou at times.
Parquet Courts released an album in April called Human Performance. And that'll be all. Next up, we have an album called Fever Dream from an artist called Ben Watt. Ben Watt, not super familiar with Ben Watt. He's an English singer, songwriter, producer. His music, I would describe Fever Dream as near adult contemporary, clearly influenced by 90s era Paul McCartney, kind of that. Sorry, Tom, I know you're a big fan of
I am.
Chaos and Creation in the Backyard yep. and Flaming Pie, but it's a bit hokey.
It is.
So you hear a lot of clean electric guitar noodling over a chill, hand-drummed groove, and vocals try to sound pretty but are loaded with attitude at the same time. I'm really not buying it. This sound lacks life and lacks ideas in the songwriting. Nothing about Fever Dream is offensively bad, but there isn't anything remotely unique or exciting about Ben Watt is doing on this record. I'll pass. Weekends I remember mostly aunts and friends. He remained the silent ghost. I can't think what I missed the most. Sentimental stuff. Following Ben Watt, we have an album called Sleep Cycle from an artist called Deacon. Deacon is the stage name of Josh Dibb, who is a founding member of Animal Collective. So knowing that, if you've listened to Animal Collective, and if you haven't, you're probably not listening to this podcast. Sleep Cycle sounds like an Animal Collective, except it was about 50 to 75% of the sonic layers stripped from the sound. I think where Sleep Cycle differs is primarily in the songwriting itself. This record is designed to provide mood and ambiance, but not structure or melody, yet still utilizing a lot of the familiar sounds and motifs Animal Collective have branded as their own over the years. I enjoyed this record for what it is, ambient, mood-based exploration. However, if you go into this expecting another Animal Collective album, you're really going to be disappointed.
Next up, we've got a new album from Brian Eno called The Ship. Now, let's get this disclaimer out of the way. Nothing that I can ever say will change the fact that Brian Eno is a freaking master.
Master.
The guy is a legend in both production, songwriting, his work with Roxy Music, his solo work, his production work. He's changed the face of rock music, ambient music,
Coldplay.
Multiple genres. Right. He's done a lot of great stuff. I'm going to say I don't think that The Ship is up there with his great achievements. To me, this album sounds nice, but it's not really enjoyable as a musical experience. At about four tracks and a couple of those tracks spanning around 20 minutes in length, I even like Eno's ambient work, but for me, the vocals on here were a big distraction and actually detracted from the quality of the music. But even aside from that, I just feel like nothing here really had an impact on me or made me want to come back.
The ship was from a willing land.
All right, and that is going to wrap up our wrap-up of April 2016, new albums. There were some other pretty good releases. We had one from John Doe, one from Guided by Voices, whose frontman we had a solo record from like a month or two ago. Also Rogue Wave, Imarhan, Pity Sex, all these albums were pretty decent, but just for the sake of time, we're not going to get into the weeds with them. We also had a release from Beyonce.
Oh, why aren't we reviewing that, Tom?
Well, because she's doing the thing where she's going to wait to release it to all, you know, the different places. And
doing
frankly,
it title release?
Yeah, right, right. You know, like, I respect that. I understand the business perspective of that. But from two guys in Iowa just trying to run a podcast, you know, I'm looking forward to listening to the new Beyonce album. But I hate to say it, you know, sorry, Beyonce, but there's plenty of other things to listen to right now. Rather than shelling out the cash when I know that I'm probably just going to be able to stream it sometime soon, I'll just listen to something else while I wait.
I'm
not going to lose sleep over it.
If you're a huge Beyonce fan, absolutely.
Oh, absolutely.
Go out
and I would do the same thing for some of my favorite artists, but that's just not how it is for me in this case. So
we'll cover it at
a later time.
What were some of your guys' favorite albums this month? Were there any notable albums that Tom and I didn't cover that you'd like to hear our thoughts on? Tell us. We'd love to hear. Next podcast, a genre deep dive into post-rock. As we talked about earlier, Tom and I have been, you know, I think previous months we've been lamenting about the lack of post-rock. Got several big post-rock releases this month and been diving into some old post-rock from like the early 90s and even before. So that's been fun so far in preparation for this. But there's just a huge list. Tom, by the way, just so you guys know, when like we have these, we get ready for these genre or artist deep dives. Tom puts together this meticulous list, especially the genre deep dives of all these albums that we have to listen to, and it's really great because it gives there's always holes in my knowledge of these bands, and so Tom really makes sure that we're both like on point for this.
Actually going to ask if you'd seen that list because you hadn't left any comments on it.
Yeah, I've been listening to albums off of it.
Sweet.
It's a big list and it's pretty comprehensive. But I'm excited. I love post-rock, so this is going to be fun. Probably won't be out for a couple more weeks. I think we'll probably take a week to prepare for it and then get together, record it, and then we'll release it in a couple weeks. So probably get about mid-May that'll be out. Thank you guys for your continued support and participation with Velocities in Music. Tom and I love all of your comments on our YouTube videos, Facebook messages, and emails. Your participation is what makes Velocities in Music possible. So, as always, thank you for being awesome. I'm Jake.
I'm Tom.
We are Velocities in Music, moving music discussion forward.